Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to the half-hour lecture on the Finnish Basic Income System in Change. Welcome, Professor Mikko Mantasari. Hope I spelled it right. Professor Mantasari has taught and done research on social work since 1982 in the University of Tampere and on the National Research and Development Center for Social Welfare and Health. And from the year 2001 as professor of social work in the University of Jyväskylä. His current research interests are in the field of social administration, especially in evaluation studies. That's also the topic for this evening. We are very pleased that you will talk about the Finnish basic income system in change, because we also discuss it very much on the department. We have done a few lectures on this topic, as we think it's a quite important theme to discuss. Well, I would say you can start where we have your lecture and then a short discussion, and probably we can extend the lecture till 7:30, mm-hmm. 8:00. If we have a good discussion,
yeah,
we can do it a bit longer. Thank you very much, and it's your floor.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. I'm so pleased to be invited to have this lecture here, but I'm also a bit nervous because it is a bit unfamiliar surrounding for me. I know something about Ilse Arlt, but not so much about Ilse Arlt Institute. And I hope I can tell you something about the Finnish case, Finnish experience on basic income reform. I start by telling something about the political situation in Finland, because it is the framework. Without that, you simply cannot understand what is happening here, there in Finland about this topic. Please, you can make questions whenever you want. It's not necessarily so that I will go through this, and after that we discuss. If you find something you don't understand, you can ask me to clarify it. I hope I can do it. So, as you know, Danish sociologist Gösta Esping Andersen made a very famous book about different welfare systems in Europe, and he said that the Nordic countries are so-called social democratic welfare states, and the other two models he was using in his first book were liberal and conservative models. Since that, this discussion, the division, this classification has been discussed a lot, and there are like very many books and articles saying that the idea of Gösta Esping Andersen was not a good one, and the classification doesn't work very well. He himself is critical about it, but in general terms and political discussions, people usually think that the Nordic countries are more or less social democratic welfare states still, and it has been like that for many years, but not anymore so, at least in Finland. There are certain developments which makes one wonder whether Finland is a welfare state at all. Of course it is, but there are some issues which are really worrisome. For example, here, I'm sorry, this is too small to be read, but it says that from 1991 to 2010, compared to other countries, Finland is the case where lower income families, the number of lower income families has grown compared to, for example, Ireland, where in 91 there was 27% of the families were low income, and 2010 only 19. Norway 14, there is no change at all. And Denmark 15 to 14. So in Denmark and Norway there wasn't any increase in low income families, but in Finland there was. And upper income families there was a raise from 4% to 8% in this same time. So it is clearly so that Finland is becoming more and more unequal society in these terms. And compared to other Nordic countries, the difference is clear. There are many reasons for that. For example, the fact that the depression starting 91 was very bad in Finland. The drop in the level of living was faster than in many other European countries. So it was really like very bad time. And it lasted many years. And some people claim that even now, when we are having upswing in the economy, we are still lagging behind beginning of 90s in many ways. Nokia came and saved us. Nokia phones. This morning I read newspaper in my hotel during the breakfast, and somebody was speaking about Nokia trap, so that was it Germany or Austria should avoid a Nokia trap when everything seems to be going well, suddenly everything collapses. So that was something which happened in Finland after 2008, when suddenly there was a market crash in many industrialized countries, and also the sales of Nokia phones went down. So we had these troubles on the same time. There are many research reports nowadays saying that Finnish basic social security has been underdeveloped and lagging behind other European countries. Especially people who are unemployed are suffering, because the benefit for single person is currently little less than 700 euros per month, and it is being taxed so that a person get only 560 euros. Of course, it is possible to get a refund from taxes, but in any case, it is the netto benefit at the moment is about 560 or something like that. And it is very low. And many other basic social security benefits are also on the same level. So compared to high cost of living in Finland, for example, housing costs, they are really much more expensive than here, for obvious reasons. We have to build houses which are very warm, and the warming to make houses so that they don't leak warmth outside, it is expensive building, and it means that the housing expenses are high, and also food is more expensive than in many other European countries. So the meals are expensive. So the situation is so that the basic benefits are low, and because they are not big enough, so they have been, the people who are unemployed, for example, they have to get social assistance to balance and housing benefits too. About 160,000 households are getting social assistance at the moment. The concepts are different in all the European countries are using different names for this, but you understand what social assistance means. It is the last resort social benefit. Then all the other social security means fail, you still can get social assistance. It is kind of basic income in a way. It is always possible to get the social assistance.
I have a question.
Yeah.
If you lose a job, you get benefits for 500 days.
Yeah.
And after that, you get that.
Yeah, but you can also get it on the same time. For example, if you have some like a cost for medicine or some other acceptable costs, you can get social assistance and unemployment benefit on the same time. And quite many of people who are on the basic unemployment benefit receivers, they have to get social assistance to get ends meet. So the system is rather complicated. There are several social benefits which people have to get to make ends meet, and it makes it difficult.
How long are the people in average unemployed when they are unemployed?
I cannot answer that. There is
half a year.
Yeah, I should say that there are about 400,000 persons who are more or less unemployed. From these, about less than 150,000 persons are currently unemployed, or something like that. From this amount of people, about 100,000 are long-term unemployed, meaning that they have been more than 1 year unemployed. Now I take these like figures out of my mind. They might not be correct, but the system is like that. That quite many of people go to some kind of courses like education, activation measures, and so on. But they still return back to being unemployed. So this is the same situation in many European countries. I don't think there is so much differences between European countries nowadays, between many European countries here in these systems. But what we have is a new government who has been 2 years in taking care of Finland, called Juha Sipilä's cabinet. And 2015, we had an election, and the Centre Party won the election. It got 5.3% more votes than before, so it was a landslide victory for that party. And the previous government had Social Democrats and National Coalition Party and Greens, and all these lost, especially Social Democrats, felt that they really lost the elections. And so the new government 2015 was based on a coalition between center, moderates, and so-called true Finns, or a right-wing populist party, which split last summer when there was a party congress and a new chairman was elected. His name is Jussi Halla-aho. He is a member of European Parliament, and he is well known all over the Europe as one of the right-wing persons opposing strongly immigration. And because of that, the party is split, and now there is only 106 seats behind the government. Still, they have the majority, they can do what they want. And they are planning like a structural reform on Finnish social policy. And we have been watching like a horror movie, what is going to happen in Finland, at least like persons like me. Of course, quite many of people are very happy what is happening, but but not all. There are persons who are really, really scared. I am one of these. And that was the reason I asked to talk about this topic here today and tomorrow morning for the students. They have a very radical program called Finland, a Land of Solutions. Sounds really stupid to my mind, but it is political rhetorics and because people support them, so who am I to tell that the name of the program is stupid? But any case, the program is very radical, aiming at structural reforms on Finnish social policy. And there's certain tension in the air because the next elections are coming in 2 years and the time is running short for the program. So they are really like doing the best they can so fast as they can, but there always comes up something to make it difficult. And for example, last week they came to a consensus on what they are doing next, but it failed and they started to argue each other. It should be today to know what is going to happen, but they are arguing again, so we don't know what is going to happen. I will tell you more about this soon. The main goal for the government is to bring the Finnish economy to path of sustainable growth and rising employment. Not unemployment, but employment. And secure the funding of public services and social security. There's nothing wrong in these goals. They are very nice in many ways. But I took a part of the program to show what kind of main issues they are using there. The main words are competitiveness, entrepreneurship, innovation and competitive edge. These are the words which are being repeated everywhere, all the time. For example, this is not the, like something coming from the current government. It has been going on for years and years that these words are being repeated all the time. For example, in the university, we have to teach the students about entrepreneurship, something like that. It is like a holy ideology. You can speak bad about the court and church, but you cannot speak about entrepreneurship. For example, I asked my dean whether can I speak against this one. Entrepreneurship in my lectures. Dean said, you can joke about it when we are having lunch like now, but in the classroom you cannot speak against it because it is in the university accepted policy that everybody must be taught to understand entrepreneurship. And an old radical like me, I simply don't know about it enough. My education comes from Karl Marx. So, just a joke about it little. Of course I know something about it. But I don't have the the stamina or the ideology to bring it up all the time. So this is the ideological framework where the basic income experiment is coming up. It is a neoliberal ideology going around everywhere. It is not a Finnish like innovation. It is innovated in UK and in USA, but it is spreading like a mode, like a fashion, everywhere. And it's an ideology. All the ideologies are similar in a way. Yeah, you can have discussion about that. Some examples of the structural reforms they are doing. Pension reform, reform of social welfare and healthcare. This is really important. This is the biggest one. They are going to change the whole Finnish social welfare and healthcare system. From publicly owned and financed and services are mostly produced by public municipalities to a system where the services are produced by entrepreneurs, the companies, the and so on, and the public is going to be paying for that. Cutting down the local government costs, regional administration reform, municipality reform, and central administration reform. So all of these in 4 years. And the main point is that reform of social welfare and healthcare, this one, would bring 3 billion or milliard savings in social welfare and healthcare costs.
For each year?
No.
For
each year, yes, but in the future, yeah. Not in very fast tense, but in coming years, when all this has been successfully implemented, the costs are going to be 3 milliard euros in Finnish terms, in American terms, billions, 1,000 million euros, 3,000 million euros less than now, which is impossible. It's not going to happen. But this is the context for the basic income experiment. And now about it. One of the goals of the government is to experiment on basic income. And the reasons why they are doing it is to make social security system more simple, more unified, and tight, so that it's not patch on patch like it is now. And that's a good idea. Also, it is very important to create work incentives. So that's the main reason why we are having it. To see whether basic income would push people from unemployment to work. Yes. Basic income in itself, it's an idea about having unconditional sum of money towards expenses, and it is intended to reduce the amount of work involved in seeking financial assistance and to free up time and resources for other activities such as working or seeking employment. I'm having a program currently about unemployment. So whenever I try to say employment, I say unemployment. I'm sorry about that. It is like a typo, I'm not seeming to avoid. There are different views of what basic income might mean. Some people see it as a way of better society, like communist society in a way. like Erik Olim Wright, who was in Jyväskylä last week. I was there listening his speech in my university. He was very good. He spoke about concrete utopias, like internet is a concrete utopia. Nobody could believe that. And Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a very good example about it. Who could believe 20 years ago that it would be a time when everybody has all the knowledge of the world in a pocket, in a phone? It is really something difficult to understand. And this type of concrete utopias, why, of course it's possible that basic income would be something like that in the future. But for some other people, it's a tool for disassemble all the public welfare spending. And here I have Freeman, Milton Freeman, Charles Murray, US sociologist, and Finnish banker Björn Wahlroos, who is a really important person in Finland. He is the leader of Nordea Bank in all Nordic countries, very important bank. He has enormous power in his hands. And he believes in basic income as a system. And I'm quite sure, although he is a former communist, by the way, during his student times, he was taking part in the socialist movement. But now he is a very hard capitalist. And he don't want to make communist society with this experiment. Not at all. It has been a great interest in the world about this Finnish experience. For example, Süddeutsche Zeitung and Die Zeit had articles about it when it was announced, and also reports in many other European countries, as well as in USA, South Korea, Japan. And the reason for that is that although there is so much talk about basic income, and there are some experiments in the world, somehow this is what we are doing now in Finland is, in a way, it's interesting to see what is happening there. Although I'm not quite sure that this is telling the final word about it, but there have been interest on it. And I tried to show you, now let's see if there is a voice here. I don't have to do anything.
Social security system is the result of decades of development work, its basis was laid down in a very different world from ours. For this reason, a new social security model will be tried in Finland. A unique basic income experiment was launched in Finland in 2017. The aim of the experiment is to determine whether the social security system can be simplified and provide a stronger incentive for finding employment. At present, finding a job does not necessarily increase the income of an unemployed person, because earnings lower their social benefits. 2,000 random participants were chosen for the basic income experiment from among unemployed persons between the ages of 25 and 58. Kela has notified the participants of their selection, and individual citizens are not eligible to apply for basic income outside of this experimental group. During the experiments, the participants receive a basic monthly income of 560 euros. For example, should the unemployment benefit of the participant be higher than the basic income, the participant can apply for the exceeding amount from Kela. The basic income is a tax-free benefit and will not be reduced by any other income the participant may have. So, If the participant finds a job during the experiment, he or she will get both the salary and the basic income. The experiment will run for 2 years, and the employment situation of the participants will be monitored throughout the experiment, which will examine the question, could basic income increase employment and simplify the social security system? Kela will be responsible for implementing the experiment. For more information on the basic income experiment, go to kela.fi/basic-income.
There are lots of material about this in this kela.fi/basic-income. So it is also in English. So if you want to... Kela is a national social security institute. It is like taking care of the pensions if you are not... There is a basic pension system and all forms of social security like sickness benefits.
We just find funds with the Austrian equivalent.
Okay, yes. It is a huge organization and a very good one. It is working in many ways in a good way. But of course, it is also politically led. So the experiment, it was very good video, and in a couple of minutes explained a lot about it, what is going to happen, but I just go in this in detail. So it is going to be 2 years, social insurance institution, Kela, is taking care of it, and they want to know whether social security system could be redesigned to the changing nature of working life, and can social security system be reshaped so that it is promoting active participation and stronger incentive to work, and can bureaucracy be reduced? And 2,000 persons were selected randomly from December 2016, and they are being paid for their accounts, and it goes on to the next year, end of next year. 560 euros per month, without any means testing. There's a control group, which is about 173,000 people, and the idea is to compare what is happening to these 2,000 persons towards this 173,000. And that's the experiment side. The 2,000 persons who were selected were unemployed. It is really important that it has an effect on this experiment that only unemployed persons could be picked up here, not other, like low-income families with working parents, or single mothers working, McDonald's, something like that, or students, for example, which are low-income persons in Finland, they are not included here. And there has been discussions about it, whether this was a bad decision. Maybe it was, but now we are working on that data we have. And is being paid second weekday of each month, this sum 560 euros per month. Everyone gets the same one. This is an example from Kela's pages saying that there was a person called Anna who was selected to take part in this experiment, and she got a job and started on March 2017, and then she can have her salary and the basic income of 560 per month. Because it's not taxed, her level of living is clearly higher than without this experiment. So this example is from Kela's internet page. What makes it a bit difficult to understand is that the benefits Kela is paying for these persons are affected by this basic income. For example, social assistance is when it's counted up, this basic income is being counted as income there, and it of course makes it very difficult to get social assistance. Unemployment benefits. If somebody is receiving basic income, he or she should be registered with the Employment and Economic Development Office, which is unemployment office, basically, but with very long name. So they have to be service users there. Or it is not possible in this system to step out from the enrollment there, which is a bit, I think, against the idea of basic income. I have a feeling. But it is because this experiment has strong connections to the idea of seeing whether it makes people work more. Then something about research. Professor Olli Kangas, who is working in Kela, this social security institution, he's one of the leading social politicians, the researchers who are doing social policy research in Finland. Olli Kangas is one of the central figures. He was leading a group who planned this experiment, and the group proposed three different models, and the government picked one of these models. So the other models were, I feel, more interesting in a way. For example, the first model was to give clearly more money for the persons who were selected to this. I think it was 1,000 euros or something like two times more. And then there was the idea of having other type of persons also there, not only unemployed. But the decision makers, they picked up the easiest one, which is not going to be very expensive, and it is like including much what is happening already. So it was something which I think Olli Kangas was not very happy about it, although I don't know what he thinks about it. He's not taking care of the evaluation of the study, this experiment. The government has announced a competition about it, but nobody really knows who is going to be the evaluator at the moment. I tell you something about another researcher, Heikki Hiilamo, who is a professor of social policy in the University of Helsinki. He has written an article about this experiment, And he's rather skeptical about what is going to happen when this 2 years has been passed. He says that actually there are 5 goals for the experiment. The rise of employment rate among persons with difficulties to employ, streamlining of social security system, slimming the bureaucracy, diminishing the poverty, enlargement of self-determination of people, and general enhancement of working life. I think this is happening everywhere in Europe, that people who don't have vocational training are really having trouble in finding work. And this is a striking figure, that employment rate among persons without vocational training was among women less than 40% and among men 46%. So, like 60% of the women didn't have work. This, or they were outside of the labor market, which is better to say. I don't know how it is here, but I guess it is quite the same. But if you don't have vocational training, you are really having trouble in getting work. And for these people, of course, some kind of basic income would be very, very important help in their lives. There's much discussion about the word. I can't translate it in any language. It is kannustinloukku. It means that you are in a situation where you get the benefit, let's say social assistance or unemployment benefit, and you are offered a very low level, low wage job. You lose your benefits and you have to work with very, very low wage. And so this is called kannustinloukku in Finnish discussion. It is, for many people, it is the most important question in social policy. How we get rid of this, so that people are they are compelled to take the work, any work. And that many young people don't really like this idea. It is like a slave work. You are compelled. You don't have any options. You don't have free choice in your life. Incentive trap. And the reason for incentive trap is that the social security is too good. As I started by saying that Finnish basic income, basic social security is not too good at all. It is in a very low level in many ways. But for the parties in the right, it is too good. According to Hiilamo, the experiment cannot lead to changes in 2 important groups of people because they are excluded from the experiment design. Mothers, one of the interesting features in Finland is that mothers who are taking care of their children, they get a certain amount of money each month not putting the children to daycare, not using the services gives you right to get some money. I don't know. It is probably the only case in the world.
It's the same in Germany.
Is it the same in Germany?
We had a discussion about that you are allowed to go, that you have the right to a kindergarten, that adopted a Finnish system, that you have the right also to stay at home and get money.
Okay.
It came from the Conservative Party.
Yeah, yeah. So, thank you of that, because I thought that only Finns can be so really stupid that they could get this idea. Not using the services, you get paid in a way which makes your further career very difficult. So, for example, women without vocational training, this is really a bad news. It is like a poverty trap, not an incentive trap, because it is really important to get to work as soon as possible in a situation like this. There might be issues here, I don't know. And the students. In Finland, all the students can get 340 euros per month for 64 months. And it is time-based. After 64 months, you don't get any money at all. With basic income, if it would be like 560 euros per month, and the students would be included in this experiment, we could say something about it, whether it makes it more difficult for the students to stop their studying and have their degrees and go to the working. Because that is being considered a serious problem. Very many of the students are studying for 10 years, so on. Too long time. Yeah, it is not a very good idea. But mothers and students were left out of this experiment, so we don't know anything about whether this system would influence the situation or not. Dismantling the bureaucracy. Hiilamo says that especially the National Coalition Party, the party which is the rightist party in the government at the moment, has been speaking about dismantling the bureaucracy for years. And it is like Hiilamo says, it is easy to say that we are cutting down the red tape, we are cutting down the bureaucracy. But in social policy it is really difficult. For example, how to cut down the bureaucracy in social assistance. You have to be very careful when you do to make the decision on social assistance. You have to check out all the bills and all the income papers to see what is really the situation to make it lasting decision. So if the experiment would really intend to cut down the bureaucracy, the level of the paid money should be higher, because this 560 euros per month is on a level which makes it still possible that people need social assistance. It might have effects on poverty. It might have positive effects, especially if it would be a bit higher than it is now. But Hiilamo says that this is not going to solve the problems of poverty at all in Finland. It is on too low level. And much of this discussion comes back to the need of social assistance. Like, in rhetorics, one of the goals is to increase the self-determination of people who are involved in this. Really, it can be good on it if the social assistance need would be lower than it is now. But here we come to another topic, which is, to my mind, it is very important in social work terms, really. Like, why I'm personally I'm not very big fan of social income, basic income, because I know that there are people who are having difficulties with money, like persons who have dependence problems, some kind of addiction, for example, or have some crisis in their life so that they are not very good on handling money. And I don't know what is going to happen to these people who got this basic income in the beginning of month, and it might be higher than this system if it is going to be implemented in Finland. So let's say it is 800 euros or something like that. When the 800 euros is being used, what is coming then? What is happening then? It is really important to find the answer to that. Is it possible to still have some kind of supplementary system on that or not? Or does it lead to a situation when people are left alone or only to the assistance of church, for example, or some other associations like that? We had a Paltamo experience in Finland for 5 years. All the unemployed persons were employed in a small municipality in the northern part of Finland. So everybody got work. And there's research about it, what happened there. And it shows that it was a place where there was a huge unemployment in this very northern, poor municipality. When everybody got work, the quality of life and well-being of unemployed increased. But after the experiment ended, real effects on unemployment were very small. So I don't know, maybe this is something we have to see when the experiment ends. It might lead more like human way of doing activation policy. Nowadays it is in many ways connected to social control in a very strict way. People who are working with long-term unemployed hope for this model to get it because they feel that if there would be a basic income system, there wouldn't be so much trouble in getting people motivated to find work. Like now they are saying that much of their efforts go on very elementary discussion about motivation, and it doesn't help anybody very much.
But in this Paltamo project, what kind of work did they get if there was so high unemployment? Was work invented, or where did the work come from? What kind of
it wasn't very. There was social enterprises. They founded social enterprises. Also the municipality employed lots of people. Paltamo is a very small place. There are like 5,000 people or something like that living there. So it is possible to try something like that.
And how long did it work?
5 years. 5 years. Yes. So it was rather a long time. And the well-being and health were monitored closely. And so it clearly showed that getting work helps people, makes them like more happy in their lives. Mm-hmm. But the lasting effects were minimal in their best. So after 5 years, the situation went back to normal. So you might know at this point. Please.
Why did the situation change back to the way it was before?
Because they lost their jobs after 5 years. They were employed for 5 years, but then The project ended and the extra money which were pumped there by the state ended. So after that there was a normal like situation between labor market situation fell back to the normal, so-called normal, which meant that 20% of the people became unemployed again. That's not good, of course. So, I have spoken about the Finnish experiment, and it clearly doesn't say the final word about basic income at all. After the experiment, when it's ending next year, we know something more about how people work when how people act when they get this amount of money more in their lives. But whether it is implementable in all Finland or not, I don't know, maybe not. There's already criticism among politicians that this experiment is costing too much money and it doesn't say too much about anything. It is going to be only a answer a partly to important questions.
What will happen with the 2,000 persons when the experiment ends in January 19?
Yeah, I don't know.
They're still unemployed.
Hopefully not. I don't know. It is something we really don't know. There is going to be some kind of follow-up for these people too after the 2018. But nobody knows.
But was there already some
there isn't any. Yeah, we are almost half of the project, but nobody, there's no open information of what has happened there.